Quiz time. Are the following words Chinese or Japanese? First. Yes, it's Japanese. Next. It's Chinese. Next. Actually, this is both Chinese and Japanese. And finally. Actually, this is neither. This is Thai. What, you thought all Asian languages are the same? Racist. Hello everyone, welcome to the LangFocus channel, and my name is Paul. Today's topic is the question, how similar are Chinese and Japanese? A lot of people look at a map of Asia and see how close Japan and China are, or they might look at a sample of Chinese and Japanese writing and think that something looks similar, and they might conclude that the two languages are similar. But are they really similar? Well, the short answer is no, they are completely different languages, but Japanese has been highly influenced by Chinese in its vocabulary and in its writing system. Chinese and Japanese do not share any common origin, and they don't belong to the same language family. The Chinese languages belong to the Sino-Tibetan language family, and Japanese, as far as we know, belongs to the Japonic language family. Phonology. First off, the phonology of the languages is very different, with the most basic difference being that Chinese is a tonal language while Japanese is not. A tonal language is one in which there are tones or pitches that help determine the meaning of the words you use. If you use the wrong tone, then the meaning of the word changes. Here's an example, the word for teacher,
老师,
and the word for naive,
老师,
and the word for old-fashioned,
老师.
So I'm sure that Chinese teachers get called naive and old-fashioned all the time by mistake. Or maybe not by mistake. In Japanese, there are basically no tones like this that determine the meaning of words. In Japanese, there is something called pitch accent, which means that the syllables of a word have either a higher pitch or a lower pitch, but they're not like the tones in Chinese because they typically don't determine the meaning of the word. They're more like stress in English. Structure. The structure and grammar of the two languages is completely different. At the most basic level, Chinese is an SVO language, while Japanese is an SOV language. Here's an example in Chinese.
他说中文.
This means he speaks Chinese. And you can see SVO, subject, verb, object. And here's that sentence translated into Japanese. 彼は中国語を話します. Here we can see SOV, subject, object, verb. And you can see there are some extra little words in Japanese that don't exist in the Chinese sentence. For example, Japanese has the topic marker wa, which doesn't exist in Chinese. And Japanese also has the object marker o, which doesn't exist in Chinese. Chinese is an analytic language, which basically means that you create a sentence by placing independent elements side by side. Analytic languages like Chinese do not use inflection. Inflection means modifying words to indicate some kind of grammatical meaning, like plural, gender, tense, or case. You don't change any part of a word in order to change its meaning. Instead, you can add to the meaning of that word by adding an extra word next to it. Japanese, on the other hand, is an agglutinative language that uses inflection. Agglutinative languages use a lot of affixes. Rather than just placing independent words side by side, you attach additional pieces to words to add or modify meaning. This kind of inflection in Japanese means that Japanese words are often longer than Chinese words, and that it may take a few words in Chinese to translate one Japanese word. In these Chinese sentences, we can see that there's no inflection.
我去学校.
This sentence means I go to school.
我去学校.
This sentence means I went to school. So no part of the verb is changed to indicate the past tense. We can show the past tense by just adding a time expression. Now these similar sentences in Japanese show inflection. This sentence means I go to school.
私は学校へ行く.
I went to school.
私は学校へ行った.
And the polite form of I go to school.
私は学校へ行きます.
I want to go to school.
私は学校へ行きたい.
In this Japanese example, we use inflection, changing the word iku to the iki form, and then we use agglutination to attach a form that shows intention, tai. In Chinese, though, there's no inflection or agglutination. You just add an extra word, like this. That's just a brief sample of how different the grammar is in Japanese and Chinese. Basically, they're completely different languages when it comes to their grammatical structure. Vocabulary and Chinese characters. The one area in which there is some similarity between Chinese and Japanese is in vocabulary and in the use of Chinese characters. During a period of great Chinese influence between the 5th and 9th centuries CE, there was a huge amount of borrowing from early Middle Chinese into Japanese. Japanese originally had no written form, so Chinese began to be used as the literary language and as the language of science science and of religion. Chinese vocabulary began to be borrowed into Japanese, and the Chinese writing system was gradually adapted to fit the Japanese language. So not only were vocabulary borrowed, but the Chinese characters that represent them were also adopted. 60% of the vocabulary words used in Japanese are of Chinese origin, but that includes all of the words in the dictionary, and that includes a lot of very specialized academic and formal vocabulary that's mainly used in writing. In spoken Japanese, the number of Chinese loanwords used is much lower, at about 18%. The borrowed words were almost all Chinese nouns, even though in Japanese they might be used as verbs or as adjectives. That's just one way in which the vocabulary is used differently. But also, the pronunciation of those Chinese words that were borrowed into Japanese changed to match the Japanese phonological system, and that included the loss of the tones of those words. And also, these words were borrowed a long time ago, which means that the words have also changed in pronunciation in Chinese. So the pronunciation has diverged quite a bit, meaning that modern Japanese pronunciation and modern Chinese pronunciation of similar characters or words is quite different. And it's also important to point out that Mandarin was not the standard form of Chinese back in those days when those vocabulary words were borrowed into Japanese. So even at the time they were borrowed, the pronunciation was different from standard Chinese today. And from what I understand, the modern Japanese pronunciation of those loanwords is often more similar to modern Cantonese than it is to Mandarin. These examples show how the same words are pronounced very differently in Japanese and in Mandarin. The word for family. In Japanese, it's kate, and actually in Japanese, the meaning is more like household or home, and in Mandarin,
家庭.
Next, the word for death. In Japanese, shibo, and in Mandarin,
死亡.
Next, the word for season. In Japanese, kisetsu, and in Mandarin,
季节.
And the word for home country. In Japanese, bokoku, and in Mandarin,
母国.
So you can see that these words look the same, and they have basically the same meaning, but they sound very different. So, Chinese vocabulary represented by Chinese characters were borrowed into Japanese, but those Chinese characters were also then applied to native Japanese vocabulary that had a related meaning to those Chinese loanwords. That means that a Chinese speaker can often look at a native Japanese word and understand its core meaning without knowing that Japanese word because the Chinese character is used to represent it. So Chinese people can often read a text in Japanese and they can make sense of the basic meaning of it based on the Chinese characters, but they won't understand all the details. And the same is true in reverse. Japanese people can look at a Chinese text and kind of make sense of the meaning of it based on the Chinese characters that they know. But it is easy to misunderstand the details of what's written, especially if they have zero knowledge of the other language. Here are some Japanese example sentences that have the same Chinese characters, but the meaning is very different because of the inflection that's used. Neko wa sakana wo taberu. That means the cat eats fish. Neko wa sakana wo tabenai. That means the cat doesn't eat fish. Neko wa sakana wo tabeta. That means the cat ate fish in the past tense. Neko wa sakana wo taberu tsumori. The cat plans to eat fish. Neko wa sakana ni taberareta. That means the cat was eaten by a fish. So a Chinese speaker reading these sentences would get the core meaning of the Chinese characters, but they would miss some meaning in the inflection, for example, the negative or the past tense or intention or the passive form, especially the last example, could be highly misunderstood. So imagine you're an English speaker reading something with English loanwords. It might look something like this. Cat blah, fish blah, food blah blah. Of course, even after just a little bit of study in Japanese, a Chinese speaker could probably learn enough to understand basic Japanese sentences like that. For me, as someone who studied Japanese to a relatively advanced level, the same is true in reverse. When I was in Taiwan last year, on the subway, for example, I could read a lot of the advertisements and I would get most of the meaning. I wouldn't understand all of the Chinese characters, but I would get usually 3 out of 4 of them. And the fourth one would be new to me because in Chinese there are a lot of characters that actually aren't used in Japanese at all. But just getting 3 out of 4 of them was often enough to understand the basic meaning of that advertisement. But of course I had no idea how to pronounce those Chinese characters, and if I tried to read them out loud like Japanese, I would hear laughter from both my girlfriend and from local bystanders. It might seem strange that I can look at a Chinese character in Chinese and understand what it means without knowing how to say it, but think of it as a symbol like a number. The number 7, right here, is pronounced differently in different languages, but when you see it, you know what it means, no matter how you pronounce it. Chinese characters are kind of like that, except that they represent a much wider range of meanings. The Chinese characters used in any particular sentence can be very different from those used in the other language for a sentence of similar meaning. And in Japanese, there are a lot of compound words that were created from Chinese characters, but those compound words don't actually exist in Chinese. These are called wasei kango, which means something like Chinese vocabulary created in Japan. Here are some examples of wasei kango. Some were created to represent things unique to Japan, like ninja, geisha, and others were created during the Meiji period to represent Western concepts like democracy, minshu. So even though you might recognize a lot of characters when you look at some text in the other language, they might be used in a very different way, so the meaning will be unclear. A Chinese speaker might be confused by wase kango when they try to read some Japanese, and Japanese people might be confused when they read Chinese because there are a lot of Chinese characters that were never borrowed into Japanese in the first place, or they're not used in modern Japanese. But in either case, even basic knowledge of the other language would help in reading comprehension quite a bit. Japanese returned loan words in Chinese. So as we've discussed already, lots of Chinese vocabulary was borrowed into Japanese, but some Japanese vocabulary has also been borrowed into Chinese. A moment ago I mentioned wase kango, Japanese vocabulary created from Chinese roots, vocabulary that didn't exist in Chinese. But some of those wase kango have actually been borrowed from Japanese into Chinese. Some sources say that such vocabulary accounts for around 30% of modern Chinese vocabulary. Of course, the way those returned loanwords are pronounced is based on the modern Chinese pronunciation of the Chinese characters. Here are some examples. The word for history in Japanese, rekishi, in Mandarin,
rishi.
The word for industry in Japanese, kogyo, in Mandarin,
gongye.
The word for electron or electronic in Japanese, denshi, in Mandarin,
dianzi.
The word for injection in Japanese, chusha, in Mandarin,
zhushe.
The word for philosophy in Japanese, tetsugaku, in Mandarin,
哲学.
The word for system in Japanese, keito, and in Mandarin,
系统.
And most Chinese people these days are probably not even aware that those words were borrowed from Japanese. It's also important to point out that in mainland China, simplified Chinese characters are now used, as opposed to the traditional Chinese characters used in Taiwan and in Hong Kong. That means that someone from mainland China may have some more trouble recognizing Japanese kanji than someone from Taiwan, for example. So in short, Chinese and Japanese are very different languages, especially the spoken languages, even though there was a lot of vocabulary borrowed from Chinese into Japanese, and a little bit from Japanese into Chinese. Only in writing are those two languages somewhat intelligible because of the Chinese characters that are used. So, the question of the day for Japanese speakers, what's your experience when you look at a Chinese text? Are you able to understand the basic meaning based on the Chinese characters? And similarly, for Chinese speakers, what happens when you look at a Japanese text? Can you understand the basic meaning? Or do you get confused because of the different way that the Chinese characters are used? Thanks again to all my Patreon supporters, and I want to say thanks to all the new subscribers who joined this month. There are a lot of you, and you are very welcome and very appreciated. Thank you for watching. Have a nice day.